How do we improve our pastures quickly with limited cost, especially when we're starting out with very, very poor quality soils? I'm Rob from Dowdle Family Farms, and we've been doing this over the last several years in a variety of different ways. And in this video, we're going to talk about how we're doing this in this 5-acre field right here. Now, there are many other different ways, and one of those is overseeding your pastures with different high quality forages. And if you haven't seen our video entitled How to Improve Pasture Overseeding the Red Field, I encourage you to check out that video as well. I'll put a link to it in the description, and it'll be linked on the end card of this video. However, this field that we're standing in right now is what I call Field A. It's one of two fields that's part of a 10-acre project that we're using to increase the productivity of these 10 acres with cover crops and livestock. We've got a playlist that this video is also a part of that shows how we're doing this in a variety of different ways with cows, pigs, cover crops, mulches, and many other methods. So check out that playlist. There are many different ways of improving the quality and the productivity of our pastures, and one of those is to plant more productive forages. The problem that we run into with that is when we have poor soils that are in underperforming pastures, planting it with something else that's not going to grow very well does not make a whole lot of sense, especially when it's cost a lot of money to add the fertilizers, liming, and everything else we need to grow those forages. One of the goals with regenerative farming is to increase the soil life in our soils, increase the carbon content or the organic matter of our soils. The reason we want to increase the carbon content or the organic matter of our soils is that with each 1% of organic matter per acre, what you run into is the soil will hold an extra 16,500 gallons of water. That's the equivalent of a little bit more than half an inch of rain. So the original plan in this field was to feed about 60 bales of hay to the cows in this individual paddock. That would have been importing about 30,000 pounds of dry matter into these 5 acres. For many reasons, it didn't work out the way we had wanted. It was too wet. The truck delivering the hay got stuck. Also, we don't have water in this paddock, so the cows would have had access to an additional 20 acres or so, where they do have a pond, but it's also where I work with the pigs a lot, and they would have created a bit of a mess, and so it was just much easier not to feed them here. But that 30,000 pounds of dry matter in the form of hay and then in the form of manure would have helped jumpstart the productivity of this pasture really dramatically. I'm kind of glad that it didn't work out though, because I did overseed a fixation Belanza clover. Now, Belanza clover grows really well in wet soils, and it tolerates much more acidic soils than most. So the plan for this field is to let that Belanza clover go to seed, then we'll bring the cows over here to graze it. I realize they won't get the optimum nutrition out of the clover because it'll have gone to seed. However, we will have formed the seed bank, the cows will knock it down, and then we'll plan on replanting our warm season cover crop mix. Now, we could buy a bunch of poultry litter or other stuff to apply to this field, and it would help a lot. But one thing that people talk about in applying composts is that composts cost a lot of money, they're labor intensive, and more importantly, they only help the top little bit of the soil. Yes, they help soil life down deeper, but the thing that I like about our warm season cover crop mix is that it has deep roots. The roots of that sorghum sudangrass, which is the base of the cover crop mix, can penetrate into the soil up to 2, 3, and many times even 4 feet deep, especially after it's regrown. It has a world of a lot of biomass, not just above ground, but also below ground. Above ground production, it can produce up to 8, 10, or even 12 tons of dry matter per acre. That would be the equivalent of, in this pasture, having 50 tons of dry matter applied to the ground per acre. However, that's not all. The thing that I really love about those deep roots is not only does it help break up compaction, is that when plants grow, they release root exudates. Root exudates are composed of things like carbohydrates and also some amino acids. And what those root exudates do is they feed soil life. The microbes in the soil, the mycorrhizal fungi, the earthworms, and many other microbial activity that I don't really understand. What I do know is that when it releases those root exudates, that soil life in turn helps provide the plants what they need to grow, and that includes everything from the nitrogen, the phosphorus, the potassium, the water, and everything else. So when those root exudates are growing, they're growing not just the 5, 6, 8 inches deep that you might get if you apply a world of a lot of compost, but when they're growing 3 or 4 feet down into the soil profile, what they're doing is they're helping increase the carbon content of the soil really, really deep into the soil surface. I have seen the benefits of the sorghum Sudangrass cover crops, and I'm telling you, they make a huge, huge difference. Sorghum Sudangrass does have its downsides. You got to be careful in how you manage it. I'll do another video on that later, but just watch out for prussic acid poisoning and also nitrate poisoning if you fertilize your sorghum Sudangrass. So back to our main plan is in that warm season cover crop mix, I'll have sorghum Sudangrass, buckwheat, sunflower, some cowpeas. I'll also include some forage brassicas and other things that'll help improve the quality of the soil out here. So by feeding our sorghum Sudangrass mix, we'll help improve the soil, produce a lot of forage, and we'll be able to grass finish our cattle on it. One thing, if we were to grow a pure stand of sorghum Sudangrass, we might get a little bit more production out of the per acre. However, we don't get as much diverse nutrition and as much diverse root exudates into the soil to help promote soil life. In terms of how much organic matter the sorghum Sudangrass adds to the soil, honestly, I don't know. I do know that it's deeper than just applying mulches to the tops of the soils. So even though rotational grazing is the predominant way people talk about improving pasture with regenerative agriculture, I'm here to tell you that if you'll try growing some cover crops and see how they improve the soil in a small part of your pasture over a 2, 3, or even 4 year period, you will notice a huge difference in the productivity, but also in the fertility of your soils. If you're interested in how to improve the quality of their pasture quickly without a whole lot of expensive equipment, check out what we did in the Redfield. I'll try to put a link to it on the end screen right here. If you're interested in how we're improving this whole 10-acre field in the different ways, check out the playlist that'll be right here. Have you tried growing cover crops for your livestock while practicing rotational grazing? If so, let me know how it worked for you. Leave a comment. Let me know what cover crops you've tried, and let me know what livestock you're using on them. If you're watching this video, though, and you don't have a farm and you don't plan on farming, and if you found it interesting, let me know in the comments below where you're located and why you found it interesting. Maybe it'll help me make a better video for you next time in the future. Until next time, it's Rob from Dattle Family Farms wishing you the best. Take care. Have a great day.